Thank you very much. Good afternoon. First, I'd like to thank the organizers for this unique opportunity to come here. That's my first trip to India, and I enjoy so far thoroughly, both professionally and personally. So it may sound strange, but I would like to revisit with you one of the oldest topics in polymerology. And I hope it will become clear why we think it's worthwhile doing so. So I'm going to present data taken primarily by Salvatore Costanzo, who was a student with us, and he's now in Montpellier, and Daniele Parisi, who is still in Crete. And so to motivate the topic, I'm going to start with something that everybody knows. That's polymerology 101, so polymers are shear thin. And we know that this is the reason why they are interesting in terms of handling, processing, et cetera, et cetera. So now here what you see is the viscosity as function of the shear rate, or can be also the dynamic viscosity as function of the angular frequency. And what you see is that at low rates, you have the Newtonian plateau, and then at high rates, you have the shear thinning. And so this is particularly important, as I mentioned, because you see the viscosity drops several decades, and that's why polymers can be processed easily. So now, one of the issues here is that to obtain the high shear data, you need to use a capillary rheometer, which of course is the simplest example also of a processing device. And that already gives you an apparent viscosity, and besides viscosity, you would not be able to measure normal stresses. And so there are another several complications associated with it when you really want to do constitutive modeling at molecular scale. So now, which are the issues with rheometric measurements? And so there are several. The most important are wall slip. And so the way people usually get around it is by measuring different geometries, and if slip is really not behavior associated with the material, so then you see difference. So in other words, when different geometries will give you the same results, then you don't worry about slip. The second is instabilities, and the most known is the so-called shear bonding, and in this case, you can either measure the velocity profile, or you measure just the stress versus the rate, and whether there is a plateau or not, you can associate this with bonding. And finally, that's the topic of the talk today, is edge fracture. And so to avoid this, actually the answer is you cannot, but you need to do repeat measurements in order to make sure that bonding edge fracture does not affect your measurements. And, or you can use a special geometry, the CPP, which I will discuss in a minute. So in addition to this, you need to be able to account for temperature control. Usually melts are processed at very high temperatures. You need, as I mentioned, to be able to measure normal stresses, in particular the second normal stress difference. And often when you need to associate with molecular constitutive models, you need to have model polymers, which means that you need to deal with small amounts of samples. Okay. To get started, let's see what we know from the linear response. That's a typical mechanical spectrum of an entangled polymer. It doesn't matter what it is, but for those who are interested, this is polybutadiene 1,4. And so we're interested in this regime here. This is the regime of the so-called entanglement network. You have the entanglement plateau and eventually the terminal flow. And there are two time scales of interest. The one is the terminal time, which is here, and the second is the Rouse time of the chain within the tube. I'm going to use the tube model framework without discussing details. And so what is interesting here is you have three regimes. You have the regime of very long times, where your chain is basically equilibrated. You have the regime between terminal and Rouse time, where the regime is basically the regime of oriented segments. And finally, stretching occurs at rates above the Rouse rate here. Right. So this is what we know from linear. So now, just one word about linear, since I mentioned tube model. In our days, one can use the tube model, which will tell you that the modulus is basically a combination of contributions from different molecular weights, obviously a different frequency. You need to know something about the dispersity of the chains. And then you need to account, of course, for a number of details, mainly the fluctuations of the ends and the constraint release. And in the end, in principle, without adjustable parameters, since the three parameters of interest, which is the plateau modulus, which is here, the entangled molecular weight, which is associated with the modulus through rubber elasticity, and the Rouse time of entanglement, which is this high frequency crossover, are known from the experiment. So in that case, you get a good fit of the data. And so you can see this better in the tan delta, which is more sensitive. And so basically, that is the main success of the tube models. And this theory is now available in free software, and it's due to Lichtman and McLeish. Okay, so now getting back to the shear thinning, the first way to think about it is the simple empirical Coxmerk's rule. And as I showed in the first slide, that's normalized viscosity versus Wasenberg number or Deborah number. So that means this is the normalized shear rate and this is the normalized frequency. And the data for a particular here entangled polystyrene melt are steady shear viscosity. And the line is the dynamic measurements. So this rule tells you that when the rate is equal to the frequency of oscillation, the two viscosities of steady shear and dynamic are identical. Okay. So then one could say that I'm going to use the dynamic data in order to extract information about shearing, or you go back to the linear data and you say, well, if there is a plateau here, I'm going to have a shear thinning simply since the modulus is proportional to the stress. Okay, so now one can even fit with a simple empirical model, it doesn't matter which one, the steady shear data and extract the thinning plateau. And typically the thinning plateau, which is the slope of this line here, is below one. It's not good if it is one because that relates, as I mentioned, to shear bonding or maybe even to wall slip. And so typically for polymers is between 0.8 and 0.9. Of course, polydispersed and other issues are important, but I'm not going to discuss them here. So now, a way to think about shear thinning is to use Rabin's shear blob model. And so the idea is that the chain consists of different segments, which we'll call blobs for now, and so that the characteristic relaxation time of each blob is the inverse shear rate. And so this shear rate then will set a difference between times which are shorter and times which are longer. For shorter times, so that means within this blob here, there will be dissipation of energy, whereas for sections which are larger than this blob, there will be basically no dissipation, but no time, and so these segments are going to deform. And so that means that this part of the viscosity will come from the integral of the g of t up to the time which sets the characteristic time of this blob here. So, and that could be a way to link this to the Coxmerk's rule, since basically in this case, we can think that sections which are larger than this blob will not communicate elastically between each other. So now the other key idea for shear thinning is the so-called convective constraint release, which goes back to Marucci, and then eventually Marucci and Iruberto. And the idea is that within the flow, this release of an entanglement is convected because of this flow, and so as this cartoon here identifies. And so then that means that the rate of the induced relaxation here is the thermal rate plus a function of the shear rate. Obviously, as I mentioned, this exponent should not be one, but this is the original formulation. And so now, this idea of CCR has been proven, especially by simulations, to be correct. The problem, however, is that this does not provide a scaling prediction. So in other words, you have to really consider different relaxation modes and different details. So in a way, there is a parameter here, the so-called CCR parameter, and that's basically the orientation tensor. And so there is no clear scaling prediction. So now if we go back to the experiments, I think Bill Gressley is one of the legends who basically is maybe also the father of molecular rheology, in my opinion. And so what he did is he identified the need to have well-defined polymers that you can synthesize with proper chemistry. In that case, it's mainly anionic polymerization. And so he used Conan plate rheometry, which is necessary in order to make sure that you have a uniform shear rate. And so this is one of the many experiments he did. That was with polymer solutions and the entangled state. And you see here the transient viscosity, so transients are important. And so here you see the transient first normal stress coefficient. So now data were taken with two different geometries, in that case is two different cone angles. And the only thing to appreciate here is that there are lines and dots. And so for the two different geometries, there are some differences here, suggesting that the early times are problematic. And I will come back to this later on. This is another classic paper coming from Lichtman at the time he was in Leeds. And so there are polyisoprenes 1,4 entangled. And so you see different transients. They were taken with cone plate geometry. And if you look at one of them, I don't know if they're clear or maybe here, you can see the transients again. So then, for instance, this is viscosity. And as you increase the shear rate, obviously the viscosity drops. And so you have an increased transient here. And so now there are some interesting features. You have the overshoot, you have the undershoot, you have steady state. But look, sometimes there is no steady state here, right? Okay, so there is, or sometimes the prediction of the model, which I will discuss in a minute briefly, it's very different from the data. So now the model is the so-called GLAM. So it's Graham, Lichtman, Miller, MacLeish. So it's the tube model adjusted, if I may say so, to the nonlinear shear response by including the idea of CCR that I mentioned, as well as chain stretch. And of course, there is a tuning parameter. But nevertheless, it does a good job. And that's the state-of-the-art model. It's a differential model for this kind of flows. The model will also predict here an undershoot. And finally, simulations, which seem to be the cleanest and perhaps most accurate experiment. This is MD, again by Lichtman, showing if you only look at the red data here, that you have the overshoot and undershoot. This is all for entangled linear polymers. So now, let me go quickly to the normal stresses. There is a zoo here, because people have been interested in measuring normal stresses for long. Pretty much all rheology legends have tried to work on the problem. Here, I will only focus on rheometric studies. And so this is with a technique that I will discuss in a minute. So that comes from ETH, the times of Joachim Meissner. And so you see here first and second normal stress differences versus shear rate. This is with a homemade device, by the way. And you see there is a thinning in both components. And you see the ratio here of the two. Okay, which has a kind of plateau here and then a weak thinning. And so the main thing is that, as we know for polymers, the N2 is always negative and much smaller than N1. And likely there are also many simulations, mainly coarse-grained models, and you see pretty much the same behavior qualitatively, right? And so this comes again from Lichtman. This is from Brills, this is from Lichtman, and you can see that there is also overshoot in the normal stresses. That's first, that's second, and then eventually steady state. So now, with all this, what's the problem with the measurements? So the main problem, as I mentioned, is edge fractures. So you do measure, so typically here is a cone, and so then there is a plate. And so while you measure, you see that eventually your sample may be expelled, right? But still, the rheometer provides nice data, right? This is not good. Even worse, there can be situations where the effect is weaker. I do not know whether it's clear, but here there are some kind of stripes here. So there is already a fracture taking place at the edge, not so extreme. But also, if you notice, the sample is a little bit misplaced. So this is a fracture and slip, et cetera, et cetera. So one has to account for this thing. So why does fracture occur? Tanner was the first who worried about the problem. And he identified fracture as the result of the action of the second normal force, which acts in the direction outside the periphery. So typically, originally, the sample is well put in a section of a sphere, because the whole thing ought to be a sphere if you follow the mechanics of the cone plate geometry. And then because of this normal force here, when it exceeds the interfacial tension that keeps the sample in place, then you have formation of fracture, right? And the fracture evolves, as you see in this cartoon here, over time. So then this second normal force is basically proportional to the interfacial tension over the height of the outer edge here. So now this original prediction was made for second order fluid, and later, more recently, Fielding improved this for more realistic fluids like Gieseckus, Johnson Segelman, etc. So the prediction is a bit more complicated, but the key physics, I think, is here. So then one should actually worry about this problem here. And so with this, the main question is whether we can measure reliably all three components, viscosity, first and second normal stress coefficient for entangled melts and solutions, and of course at elevated temperatures and with all the other details that I mentioned, like for instance sample amounts and so on. And so we approach the problem through the macromolecular parameter space, so we need to worry about different kinds of polymers. This is what I would call macromolecular architecture. And so we look into melts and solutions of linear chains. And so typically you see that you have polystyrene polyisoprene with different plateau moduli, which means also different TGs, but importantly also different propensity for slip. Okay, so that's important. I'm not going to show any molecular weights because everything I will talk about is entangled, but obviously if I have an entangled polymer solution, it means that it has very, very high molecular weight, so that with the dissolution that takes place through the solvent, it remains entangled and so on. This is well checked and so on. So then branch polymers, the stars are the simplest possible branch polymers because they have one branch point. So it's a good starting point, and also the stars are the next molecular structure which is reasonably well understood in terms of linear response. And then comps are very important for reasons I will mention in a minute, and I write here control. And finally, rings, for which I will say a few more words later on. So this covers pretty much the landscape of polymers. So now the reason I mention control is because the way we approach the problem is that we quote design systems so that they have well-defined characteristics. Like for instance, this cartoon here shows you comps which have the same linear backbone molecular weight. They have the same number of branches, but then the molecular weight of the branches changes. So in this way, you can have a control of the molecular parameters, how they affect the rheology. And this can be done in collaboration with chemists. In our case, for this, things are mainly Rovers, Hadzikristidis, and Matyachevsky. Okay, so now I already indicated that we're going to use the cone partition plate geometry. So if asked the question, how can I deal with edge fracture? The first answer is, I cannot do anything about it. All I can do is just try to postpone its effect. And that's what Paulet thought in the 50s, and then later Meissner worked on the topic more intensively. So here's the idea. The idea is that you have your cone, which is connected to the motor of your rheometer. This is can be upside down too, it doesn't matter. This is for a strain control rheometer. And so then you have your sample. So this is the transducer, which is linked here to this 6 millimeter, this is just an example, diameter plate. So basically, you measure only throughout this red arrow. So you overfill your sample, and you put an outer ring, which is connected through a bridge to an inner part of the rheometer, which is not moving. And so then, in this way, you have the outer edge of the sample here. As the motion starts, edge fracture takes place, but you don't care in principle because you measure here. So the edge propagates, so up to the point that it reaches this particular point here where you really measure, you can measure without problems in principle. That's the idea. And so that's easy to implement, and so that's the design. So this one here is basically, this gray part is your measurement tool, which in this case is this top plate. The bottom green part is the cone. Your sample is the red one, and so the outer ring is this one here, which is connected through a bridge somewhere in a stable position. And that's a very simple tool that can be implemented in any rheometer. So basically what you're going to measure then, is a stress or viscosity which go through a plateau, actually should have an undershoot here, which I will explain later on, and then reaches steady state. Okay, so that's what happens. Then at the end of a measurement, I hope it's clear here, that's easy to obtain because this is polystyrene, so you can quench it, and you see the sample. You see that's the outer part, and so you see again the effects of fracture. But as long as it doesn't hit this inner part, which is the measurement part, it doesn't matter. Your measurement is fine. So now when the measurement is affected, the macroscopic observation is that you don't have steady state. Okay? Your stress keeps on decreasing, right? And so that's basically the main outcome of this. So with this, let's see some data, and I'll show you lots of them, and sorry about that. So this is now different polystyrenes here. This is entangled solution, this is an entangled melt, and so they're the same. So typically what you see is viscosity, transient viscosity. You increase the shear rate, it drops down, and then you see the evolution of the peak, you see the undershoot here, and so also the linear envelope that comes from the dynamic data is well fitted into the low rate regime, so everything seems fine. The range of Weissenberg numbers based on the terminal time covered goes from below 1 up to about 1,000, and so we'll worry about the scaling of the peak here, the undershoot, and the steady state. So this is just some more data from the polyisoprene star, which pretty much shows the same behavior as you see the peak, the undershoot, and the steady state. So now, when you look at the linear polymers, so this is normalized viscosity versus actually this is Weissenberg number, this is different molecular weights, actually for solution is the same, and you see that pretty much the Koch-Marx rule is valid because the lines are dynamic data, and all molecular weights, when we have appropriate scaling, go together. Same occurs for stars, but the only difference is that the slope here is quite different. Here the slope is 0.67, whereas before the slope was 0.89. So consistently we see that stars have different thinning slope. And so this is the comps now here. So the comps are, as I mentioned, same number, same backbone molecular weight, same number of branches. All that changes is the size of the branches. And so the largest branches are going to introduce more effective dilution into the system. And so then in this direction, you have a weakening of the slope in this direction. So basically, the less dilution you are here, so you're very similar to the slope of a linear backbone. And then as you increase dilution, you go in this direction. And so you not only have a weaker slope, but also you have a progressive failure of the Koch-Marx rule, which is what I show you. Okay, so now let's look at the peak. The peak is an indication of the maximum deformation of the material before it reaches steady state. And so what you see, now I plot here the peak strain as function of Weissenberg number. This Weissenberg number is based now on the Rauch time. And the reason for this is that, as I indicated, above the Rauch rate, we start having stretching. So nicely below this value, we have all data collapsed into the value of 2.3, which is the Doi-Edward prediction for alignment of the segments. And when stretching takes place, you have an increase. The data collapse, they have this weak increase of, with a slope of 0.3. which has been actually recently predicted by Ken Schweitzer with a theory with a so-called gritting force, which I'm not sure personally I fully understand, but it's very interesting that at least there are predictions pointing to this. And by the way, there are also lots of data that are cited here by Cici Wang that confirm this. The other interesting point for us in terms of metrology is that we can go to Ras Weissenberg numbers of 40. Which we think is reasonably good. And that's our record so far. Now, when you go into the stars, now I plot them against the terminal Weissenberg number. The reason is that there are still issues as to what is the proper Rauch time of the star. But here I have now the data for the linear chains, which are here, and the stars are all here. There is a lot of scattering of the data. Well, so it is. But basically, you barely see the data going beyond a constant value, which is basically what I would call the orientation. So then it's more difficult to stretch the stars. And so there is another indication of this kind of deformation, and that's the fractional overshoot that I plot here. And so this is the linear data, and this is the star data. So there is a very clear deformation. So in other words, the overshoot in the linear change is much larger. So now, before going to the undershoot, I need to tell you how, at least for the linear change, the modeling is done, and this is due to Marucci and Irumberto. So they go to the Doyle-Edwards, actually to a version of the GLAM model. So it's a tube model, but it's the integral version where the orientation, which is pretty much this exponent, this part here, and this is the Doyle-Edwards tensor, and this here is the deformation gradient between the two times, is decoupled from the stretching, which is the stretch factor is here. This GI and TI is basically the distribution of relaxation times and basically the mechanical spectrum. And this one here is an expression of the deviation from the Gaussian behavior. And this here is a scalar, which is a function of the Doyle-Edwards Q vector. So now, before actually having an expression for the stretch, for the evolution of the stretch, we looked, actually, Marucci basically, looked into the simulations of Bamin Komami, who basically did molecular dynamic simulations, equilibrium and non-equilibrium, of entangled polyethylene chains. And so this is a snapshot of what he sees at a given time, where the chain is stretched and then starts really relaxing, and over time it relaxes more and more and more and eventually stretches again. So there is a periodic stretch and retraction of the chain, and that's basically tumbling, right? And so based on that work, there is an expression for the tumbling function, which has this periodic function here, obviously the cosine, and this omega is the period of the tumbling, and then at some point there will be a decorrelation of tumbling events, which is described by this rate beta. This is all in a way in the model empirical because it's based on the simulations, and that basically is the expression here, okay, for the evolution of the stretch. So when they take this into account, you will see that the transient data of the viscosity for different melts and solutions with the same number of entanglements are in pretty good agreement with the experiment. Right? So then the suggestion is that you need to account for tumbling in order to reach this agreement. And so melts and solutions with the same number of entanglements behave in the same way. So now the idea is whether you can test this. And it's almost embarrassing. I can only show you a qualitative trend, and that's Murphy's Law, because the PSI plant experiment in August was canceled because of problem with the reactor and rescheduled only 3 weeks ago. So we didn't manage to get analysis of the data. But nevertheless, I'll tell you what one can do with polystyrene. Right? Polystyrene is a good material for this because you don't have to do in situ measurements. All you have to do is to quench your material since its TG is very high and then keep your sample and take them to the reactor whenever time allows. That means that your sample, of course, should be properly mixed with a deuterated analog, et cetera, et cetera. So then what we did is we had the stress transient, and so then we quenched the sample at different positions, okay? And then we kept the quenched sample, and then we studied in the flow vorticity plane. And so I only show you photos. So in the beginning, it looks like you have almost homogeneous behavior, then you are close to the peak, and so you have clearly deformation, and so then right a little bit after the peak, the deformation is larger. Somewhere in the range of what I would call now undershoot, the deformation seems, it is only qualitative, to be a little bit reduced, and eventually at steady state again, it's a bit larger. Okay? So we hope that through this analysis, we can learn something more and have a more direct evidence about tumbling. Okay, so now with this, let's see the scaling of the undershoot. So this is the strain on the undershoot as function of the Weissenberg number. right? And so this is linear data, Meltzer solution. So I will add comps, and you see that the scaling is pretty much consistent, obviously within error. And so then one can go further to look at the fractional undershoot. And so this is fractional undershoot for linear Meltzer solutions. And so I can add to this stars and comps. And again, within the uncertainties of the experiment, there are universalities which are followed, and that's the point I want to make. So now let's go to the rings, which is the last architecture I want to mention. Well, rings are particularly important because since the 60s we know that even DNA is can come in ring form, but recently, of course, there is a lot of interest in biology because of the genome project and so on. And so one can think that, of course, a 2-meter DNA can pack extremely effectively into our cell, right? And the reason that this is done is because, as this cartoon here shows, it does so by forming loops. And a loop for us now a ring. And I forget about everything else because I don't know anything about biology, and I care about rings. So now I go back to the original linear data, and I show you here a linear polymer with the plateau and the terminal time, as I showed before. And then I show you the same polymer where basically I managed to link the two ends. In fact, I'm totally incompetent, as I guess you know, in doing so, but the chemists do so. And so the trick now here is that not all chains are going to link, and so you need to be able to separate the rings from unlinked linear chains. This is the reason why the field was basically hindered from any development for about 30 years, until finally Taihun Chang, who pioneers the liquid chromatography at critical condition, find a way, which I'm not going to discuss here now, to separate the two. In doing so, you have, for example, the linear here, the ring here, and the rest is what I would call now contaminants, right? So it's linear and double linear and so on. So when you get the purified ring, which of course you'll get it, that's the price you pay, in a few tens of milligrams, you see that the behavior is completely different, right? And so it's nice high frequency data together. Anyway, here you have a power law, you don't have a plateau, and then you have the terminal slope. And so there is a theory, and those of you who were in Houston at the rheology meeting, you heard from basically Mike Rubinstein, who developed the theory, how this is done. But the key idea is that unlike the spaghetti type of plateau here, with rings you don't have any kind of network formation. The rings are going to make room for the neighbors by changing locally into double folds. Okay, that's the way to maximize the entropy. This is what they call a lattice animal, or now they call it fractal Lubin global model and so on. Key point is that if you account for this as a kind of sequential hierarchical motion of ends, where each end of a loop is an end, like a branch polymer without branches, you find a power law here which is close to 0.4, actually it's 3/7 here, right? And so the model predicts the theory very well up to the terminal regime. Then the terminal is a bit more complicated, but we don't care about it today, because only going back to Cox-Merz, we know that the thinning of a ring should be much weaker than that of a linear polymer. And true enough, I show you here the data. This is for two different molecular weights, the linear with a thinning slope of 0.89 and the ring with close to 0.6, right? So it's akin to a Rouse chain, actually, even though it's a ring. And the Cox-Merz rule works for rings as well. And here is now simulation data. This is MD simulation from Kramer, Grest, etc. And so you see that the simulations are in very good agreement with experiments, both for linear and for ring polymers. Okay, so that's conclusions of the first part. I guess I have 10 minutes. Oh, okay. So I think this is a simple geometry that anybody can use or make. I think also it's commercial. But anyway, the cone partition plate is a way to measure entangled polymers at high temperatures and high rates reliably. And I'm talking so far about viscosity. The transient measurements are important because you see there's a lot of information and interesting universalities that one can see. Linear polymers merged on solutions behave identically, of course, when properly scaled with plateau modulus and characteristic time, which is interesting because this is not the case in extensional flows, and so that opened Pandora's box with respect to the role of the friction coefficient and whether it's isotropic or not, and so on and so on. And finally, undershoot appears to be linked to tumbling. Okay, even though I show you that there's a model that predicts this, we still don't have the conclusive evidence in this direction. There are some differences among architectures, which I'm not going to bother you to remind you again, except to point out the particular point for ring polymers, which I think are quite unique. Let me now go in the last 5 minutes to the normal stresses. So now, how are you going to measure the normal stresses? So I already indicated that fracture is a problem. So now, when you use this cone partition plate, it turns out that the normal stress that your transducer will record is apparent because it's a function of both the first and second normal stress and also a function of the material now, which is overloaded, right? And so this is actually the outer diameter, and that's the inner diameter. Inner is what you measure, okay? And so the state of the art now is what we call CPP3, which was developed by Schweitzer. And so here's the idea. So that's again the cone. This is the outer ring, but you have now two partitions, right? So you have the outer ring, and you have an intermediate ring, which is this green one here. So now you can measure a normal force, okay, in the inner part and the normal force in the outer part, right? And so then you have in this way two apparent normal forces that you measure, and you have basically for each one the outer and the inner diameter. So in one case the inner diameter is here, in the other case the inner diameter is here. And so then you have two equations to announce, and then you get your N1 and N2. Okay, that works very well. I show you here data from Schweitzer for PDMS. That's viscosity, that's first and second normal stress coefficients, obviously with minus the second. So everything is fine. The lines are just Lotz-Meissner relationships, etc., empirical, but they seem to work well. There are a couple of issues with this. First, it's incredibly complicated to align. Second, and more importantly, it has problem with temperature control. It cannot go to high temperatures, more than 80 degrees, and also there are temperature gradients. It's really a nightmare. That's why even the inventor has kind of abandoned it, although I think this is really the way to go eventually. So I show you a very simple idea, which again is inspired from other words, and that's the following. So we go back to this equation here, and what we're going to do now is we're going to basically keep the same outer diameter and change the inner diameter. So basically you have to make two such devices. You keep the same outer diameter, you change the inner diameter, and so then you go back to this equation here. So you have two measurements, and so two unknowns, and then you're done. And so that's very easy to implement if you have a decent machine shop, which we hope we have. And so this is now the data you get. So this is data with an entangled polymer. This is polystyrene. That's the transient viscosity. I'm not going to come back to this just to show that everything is fine. In this case, the viscosity is the same, and it should be the same for the two geometers. There is no reason it's different. But the normal stresses are different, and so I'll show you here. And all you should care about is the steady state. I'm going to forget about the transients for reasons that we can discuss, but they have to do with the axial compliance of the transducer, its time response, and the range of force it can afford. So then all I will care about is those two data here. And so if I count for those two data, then I have here the total plot where I have viscosity data here, first normal force, and the minus second normal force here as function of shear rate. And so then I have lower and higher number of entanglements. The lines are the prediction of this Marucci and Roberto model that I mentioned in the beginning that accounts for tumbling. And what you see, the model does the good job that I showed before, but also here it works quite well. Now one can look in a little bit more detail and say that the model here seems to constantly over-predict the case of high number of entanglements, and of course it's tempting to think that in this case I have more shear induced release of entanglements. But this is at the moment something that we should prove. So this is the ratio of second to first normal stress coefficient, and this is the same data. You see that even I have a data point which is a bit hard to interpret, but it's there because, you know, I cannot take it out. As I increase the number of entanglements, I go from the black to the red data. So the model and the data suggest that with increasing number of entanglements, I have a slight decrease in this ratio. And so now this line here is the case where I have single mode case. And then as I increase the number of entanglements, it seems that the relaxation time spectrum toward the terminal regime goes closer to a single mode. So that seems to be in the right direction. And this is the limit of the Edwards prediction, up here for obviously zero shear. And that's when I have a small amount of non-affinity. So now these numbers here, so the ratio being between 0.1 and 0.3, are consistent with the few available data in the literature. Sometimes data are, especially from the Utah group, Magda Christensen and so on, with entangled polymer solutions. So that's, in a way, interesting because we reproduce data of 30 years ago, but with the difference that this is high temperature, this data were room temperature, okay? And so there is a big difference for this. And they were taken, of course, with flash mounted transducers. Okay, and also many simulations are consistent with this. Now, the last thing is that when you go to rings, the situation is completely different, and this is very new data. Again, I plot here the ratio of the normal stress coefficient versus shear rate. This is the linear data that I showed before, and that's rings now. Okay, same molecular weight. So you may see here, this is last year measurements, so it took us a year to change again our design to make it appropriate for higher rates. We increase the rates, and the data are the same. So for whatever this means, rings are slower to thin this ratio, if they thin at all. The ratio seems to be constant. We have no good idea now, but there are simulations underway by the GREST group, and we hope that they will help us, because as I mentioned, simulations are really much to the pleasure of many here, an ideal experiment. Okay. So I think that this simple cone partition plate device, also in a modular form, can be a great tool to measure the first and the second, in particular the second normal stress difference, which typically the models either don't consider at all, they tell you it's zero, or they will cook up a number, which also they may not even consider a small, but perhaps important shear rate dependence. So that may be good news, I hope, especially if people use it for constitutive modeling. As I mentioned, compliance is an important factor here, but so far that's all we can do. Okay, we still work in this direction. The decrease of the ratio with shear rate is very weak, but it's there. And of course, rings remain an interesting mystery for us. So we, as I mentioned, we work with chemists. So there is a group in Kaos of Hadzikristidis. Actually, this guy Polymeropoulos is really a Greek name, and so this, it's very, for some reason, he decided to work with polymers. I don't know why, okay? And so that's the group of Taehoon Chang in Korea, who is really very important for the work on rings. I already mentioned the model of the Italians, and Michael Rubinstein, with whom we work on the ring polymers. And that's funding from EU, and thank you very much.
Good. Thank you for a very interesting talk, and we have time now for a few questions.
Yeah, so this interesting CPP conant plate system that you have devised, of course, on one hand, it helps you to measure normal stress differences. But just as far to get, not to get edge fracture, can we have a simple coating of, let's say, low viscosity organic liquid on the periphery? Will that help?
Yeah. We have tried it several times. We have not managed to make it work. In fact, I alluded to the work of Suzanne Fielding. She has a prediction under which conditions not a low, but lower compared to the melt, viscosity fluid will act against this normal stress distortion. We tried to do this with more or less the same. In the case of polystyrene, that was, if I remember, something of 100 Pascal second. It did not work. Now, there are also some issues of how you properly do the sealing in a cone plate, but it's a very good idea. That would be really fantastic, except for the fact that technically, after you do this, if you succeed, you lose part of the sample, right? But the main thing that we have not managed to make it work. But I agree with you, that would be really a good idea.
No.
I can't help ask. Maybe you covered this and I didn't fully understand it, but when you go to the rings, do you expect tumbling? And if so, what's the end that instigates the tumbling?
Yeah,
is there no end? Right?
Yeah, that's a great question. I didn't show this. Actually, if the undershoot is tumbling, we can barely see it. It goes, if I have it in proper order. Wow. All right. So, okay, this is the linear of the ring. That's the linear with the undershoot, that's the ring. Basically, the sample would break afterwards, right? So we cannot, this doesn't mean that there is no tumbling, because again, we identify the undershoot as a consequence of tumbling, right? So that means that the experiment will not be able to tell you the full story. Now, to explain the ring shear thinning, Grossberg has introduced a model which is still in the making, actually, in order to explain the data. And then tumbling is considered along with this concept of the rubbing blobs that I mentioned at the very beginning. So the idea is that your ring is going to unfold, will create something like a rod, but not quite a rod. He likes to call it cucumber. Like in the past, people used to call this structure cigars, but he says now for health reasons he called it cucumber, right? That's actually it is in the mind, like this. Right? And so the idea is that with this idea of the shear blobs, while you have this, you have dissipation in this direction, and that somehow drives the thing to do a little bit of tumbling. But there is nothing we can prove. Even if this little indirect thing doesn't prove it.
Ron.
I hear right that when you put the tumbling in, you left out constraint release, left out CCR, and got good agreement. Is there an?
This is correct. In fact, I would say that. Well, I cannot find it right now, but we have it. If you can show that with and without CCR, the difference is very weak. If, however, you have CCR and you don't have tumbling, then it doesn't work at all.
So CCR without tumbling doesn't work, and if you put tumbling in, it doesn't matter much anymore whether you have CCR,
exactly.
Is that what you're saying?
Exactly, all right.
Okay, thank you.
So I have a question, small question. So we observed some deviation in results for star polymers. So will it be because the CCR has different effect on the backbone and on the stars and on the arms of the star polymer?
Could be. To be able to answer this, there are two things that we need to resolve. The first is a reliable model for stars. And actually, MacLeish and Gary Lille have modified the GLAM model for stars. So that seemed to be okay. But the second thing is important to understand whether the prediction of undershoot of the GLAM model is really associated with physics and not a problem of the decoupling approximation, right? Okay, so it's unclear. So I think it's a very, very good idea, but I don't have an answer right now.
No problems. Thank you so much.
Okay, so I think we should move on. Please join me in thanking Dmitry one more time.